you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
So we've been looking the last few weeks, and we've been talking about those things that you can't see that everyone else can see about you. Blind spots that could be our attitudes or our mindsets or our personal flaws or our characteristics or our habits or our ways that we've inherited, or more positively, our gifts. We can't see our gifts. We can't see our abilities. We can't see God's purpose for our lives. We don't see God's plan and the potential opportunities that He has given us day by day. You know, smart people don't allow their blind spots to cause them to act dumb. So if you want to be smart today, work out what your blind spots are, and then don't allow them to cause you to act dumb, because we can all act dumb, can't we? If we're being honest today, and I'm being loving, honestly. But because I'm putting myself out there and saying, yeah, I can act dumb, really dumb. But smart people don't allow their blind spots to cause them to act dumb. You know, the most common blind spot that we can have is believing others have them, but we don't. Our key quote for the series, it's a little bit of a pithy statement. We had a few of those yesterday. I noticed that they were catching. And it's this: if you can't see it, you cannot see it. But when you see it, you can't not see it. I know it's early in the morning after a wedding night, and heads are fuzzy, and voices are low. And, you know, you're like, I can't concentrate at this time of the morning. That's like a mind twister. If you can't see it, you cannot see it. But when you see it, you can't not see it. So far, we've covered two blind spot areas, which were, number one, sometimes we can't see it until there's a change in how we see ourselves. Number two, my wife's probably going, I really like that voice. Even Sean said, I've never heard you speak that low before. Sometimes it was all that dancing I did. Did you see it? Sometimes, yeah, we won't even talk about that. Sometimes we can't see it. I can't now. I'm sorry. I can't get out of my mind, and it's not a really good thing to have in your mind when you're trying to preach, but I can't get out of my mind Liz's brother with his kilt on. It's just going replaying like time and time again. I really thought I was going to go, woo, no. He was getting down and grooving. Anyway, let's carry on. Let's get back into this. Sometimes we can't see it until someone else points it out. We've been reminded the last few weeks to not allow what happens to us to determine what happens in us, to never allow the description of our circumstances to change the definition of our character, that God hasn't abandoned us to a problem. He's working towards a purpose. When we accept God's extravagance, we appreciate our worth. To have faith in the God we know rather than be focused on the circumstances that we see. To not discard the miracle because you dislike the method. That was last week's. And because God will often use things we like the least to help us the most. So let's move on to number three. Number three is sometimes we can't see it until we change our environment. For this, I want to use the story of Terah, who was a terror. Terah and Abram. It says in Genesis 11:31, one day Terah took his son Abram, his daughter-in-law Sarai, his son Abram's wife, and his grandson Lot, his son's Haran's child, and moved away from Ur of the Chaldeans, not the Kardashians, and he was headed for the land of Canaan. But they stopped at Haran and settled there. And Terah lived for 205 years using moisturizer. Sorry, last week I was encouraging the guys to use moisturizer. Because, you know, if you're going to live 205 years, you've got to start applying stuff to your skin anyway. That's another story. So he ended up dying in Haran at 205 years of age. Now, maybe that's not surprising, because when you think about it, he's lived in Haran. It's not surprising when you consider that before he moved to Haran, he lived in Ur. It kind of just speaks of hesitation, doesn't it? Where do you live? It's indecision right there. So it said Terah was heading in the direction of Canaan, but he never got there because he stopped and settled on the way. He never got there. That's so sad. He was heading to the promised land, but he never got there. In life, it's so easy when heading in the right direction to get distracted and stop and settle somewhere on the way. And if we're not careful, we're going to do just like Terah did and get stuck. When we're heading in the right direction, let's not get delayed by distraction. There's so many distractions along life's journey. Things on the left, things on the right, things ahead of us. You know, those things can distract us. Do you know, interestingly, what I discovered about Terah? His name actually means delay. Even more interesting is the fact that Haran means crossroads. So we have a delay at the crossroads. I don't need to remind you that delaying at the crossroads is not a good idea. The word crossroads means the point at which a crucial decision must be made, which will have far-reaching consequences. Yes, the consequences are that if you delay at the crossroads, you will get honked. That's what happens when you send your wife out for a horn. What is that? We paid good money for that. See, what will happen when we stop at the crossroads of life is that people will honk their horns or squeak their hornets. Because here's the thing, there are people traveling behind you that you're holding up, that are relying on you to keep moving on. And they don't just honk their horns, they will start making and using interesting hand gestures. And then they will go to another level of speaking certain phrases. Some of you know exactly what I am talking about, because maybe on the way to church this morning, someone was holding you up at the crossroads. You honked your horn, they didn't move, so you started to use your hands and bless them in Jesus' name. So Terah had reached a crossroads. I'm going to strap it onto my belt, but it was a point at which a crucial decision had to be made, because there would be far-reaching consequences. Instead of deciding to move on, he decided to stay put. So easy to do that. Let's not get delayed. Let's not get to that place where we just settle and plateau. You see, we have to make sure that we understand a blind spot can set in straight away when we start to settle somewhere where God wants us to keep moving in life. I don't mean to say that you shouldn't settle down. I don't mean to say that you shouldn't stay in a place in a certain area of your life. For example, as a married couple, stay settled in your marriage and keep growing in your marriage. But here's the thing, you don't even just stay settled in that. You keep growing. Like I was talking about yesterday at the wedding, I was saying that we need to keep investing. We need to keep up the interest. It's something that keeps growing. That's not plateau. So the blind spot for Terah was really complacency. He got too comfortable. He got to a place of familiarity, a position of security. And so moving on for him was all about taking a risk. I wonder whether you're at the crossroads in your life, the point where a crucial decision has to be made, which will have far-reaching consequences, and you're hesitating and you're delaying because it will mean taking a risk. And maybe God is going, God doesn't sound a bit like that. If he does, I'm scared. I prefer the deep God, not. But maybe he's honking his horn today. Maybe he's going, come on, it's time to move it, move it. I shouldn't use props, should I really? It's a place we can so easily get to, where our intention is to move on, but our emotions cause us to stay put. Let's not allow our emotions to overrule our intentions and overpower our actions. See, we think it's easier to stay put because somehow we convinced ourselves that there's no risk involved. Little do we realize that sometimes the riskiest thing we can do is to stay in the environment that we've created. Not that God's created, but that we've created our own little comfortable environment with our own little comfortable life duvet so we can have duvet days, as clearly some in our church are doing today. Wakey, wakey! You know that place is otherwise known as settled, secure, and satisfied, or safe, stuck, and stayed. Who would want to live in an environment called safe, stuck, and stayed? Lots of people. Lots of people stay safe. They play safe. They get stuck. I wonder whether I might just be talking about you. Have you got stuck? Sorry, I can't. I'm not putting on the deep voice, honest. It is just how it is today. I could just go, see, like Brian Houston, because I've got the voice today. That's all you're going to get. I can't do any more Aussie. The best is yet, no, I won't. Brian, I am sorry. I know you won't be tuning in. You're too busy. But if you are, I'm sorry, that was really bad. Or if anybody at Hillsong's tuning in, that's, no, please. You know, this environment that I'm talking about is it's basically called this. It's a better the devil you know environment. That's really what it is. But the devil you know isn't always your closest friend. It can be your greatest enemy. So never allow the devil you know to rob you of the life God gave you. It's so easy to do it. Better the devil you know. I grew up hearing that. I heard that in my family, better the devil you know. Basically meant don't take any risks, just better to do what you know. I worked out that that wasn't the best advice I had ever received. Better the devil you know. What a great thing. No, it's better to know the God that's given you the life that he's given you and to know how to fulfill your purpose and your destiny and move on to everything that God has called you to do and called you to be. Because God's called you to live a large, spacious life and not a small, restricted existence. A life where you can thrive, not just survive. See, better the devil we know works in the area of our intentions. Terah discovered this. And I'm going to help illustrate this today by giving you your own special gift. If we can hand out those gifts to everybody, Elaine. I'm going to give you a little toot. It's a little toot. So just as we're handing out our toots, I'm going to say this, that the reason I'm giving you this is to help you understand that there's a blind spot we all seem to adopt, that Terah adopted. See, Terah was going to move on to Canaan, but he kept putting it off, and he never actually got around to it. Years passed, and life basically slipped away because he never got around to it. How about you? What were you intending to do that you never quite got around to it? Actually, we didn't quite get around to it. It's not quite round. We were trying to get around to it, but we didn't quite get around to it. My wife did very, very well cutting those out. Maybe you were intending to apply for that job, but you never got around to it. Maybe you were intending to move house, but you never got around to it. Maybe you were intending to go to the doctor about that thing, and you never got around to it. Maybe you were going to go to the dentist, but you never got around to it. Maybe you're intending to get healthier, but you never quite got around to it. You were going to start running, but you didn't get around to it. You were going to stop eating all that cake. Oh, no, that wasn't for Paul. But you didn't quite get around to it. What were you intending to do, but you didn't quite get around to it, and now you realize that 5 years have passed, 10 years have passed. You said you were going to do something 20 years ago. You were going to do something about your timekeeping, but you didn't quite get around to it. Yay, Sean's going, I wish my wife was in here today. That's not fair, Sadie. I saw your face. It's her birthday. We'll let her off today. But I'm going to honk my horn. Don't let life slip by anymore. What is it today? Have I identified something? Maybe you weren't in that list and you're thinking, yay. Honk the horn, Pastor. Oh. But there's something maybe that you didn't get around to it. And just because I haven't actually mentioned it doesn't mean to say that God isn't challenging you about it. Come on, he's not trying to make our lives more difficult. He's trying to get us set free to be able to do the things that he's called us to do. So don't let life slip you by. Listen, take control of your emotions and turn your intentions into actions. Because now you have your own round to it. I want it to serve as a reminder that you can actually do the things that you were intending to do. I want you to take that home, slip it somewhere in your Bible, put it on your fridge, I don't know, stick it on the dashboard of your car, just to remind you to do what God's called you to do. You got to do it rather than keep saying when I get around to it. See, Haran also has another definition. It means a parched place, a dead place. That's no place to live, a dead place. A place where your potential can waste, your power can weaken, your promise can wane. That's exactly why God had to come along to Abram. And he had to say to him, listen, Abram, I called you to so much more than what you're currently experiencing in your life. And he had to reveal to him that he had a blind spot. The blind spot was the environment that they had created. Now, basically, Abraham was in an environment that his dad had created. But just because his dad had created it didn't mean to say he had to live there any longer. So God came along and said, listen, I know this is a generational thing. I want you to break this generational thing, and I want you to move into your generational blessing so all the generations after you can be blessed. That was basically the word. Through you, all future generations are going to be blessed. What a responsibility. I believe God is saying to you, listen, there are generations yet to come. If you don't break this generational curse, who's going to do it? Change the environment. Only you can.
Oh, well, you don't know my situation, Pastor. Well, that was a London accent right there. Don't know what it was.
You know, it's not as easy as that. You don't understand. It's, you know, we're all in the same boat. It's not easy. We've got things that we've adopted. We've got things that we've adapted. And we've got stuff that we've got as blind spots and we don't even see them. We do them every day. We allow them to impact our lives on a daily basis. And then we're crying out to God for why he's not breaking through in our lives. And he's going, if you could only see what I can see. And I pray that you see it. I pray that the eyes of your understanding would be enlightened, just like the Apostle Paul prayed. I want you to see what you haven't previously seen so that you will see everything in your future. So God comes along and he says, listen, I didn't call you to just survive, Abram. I called you to thrive. See, an environment isn't necessarily a physical place, but the circumstances or conditions in which we operate. Remember what Jesus said, I came that you might have life in all its fullness, in abundance. Why are we settling for less than abundance? Why are we settling for less than more? Because when we restore our get up and go, we will get around to it. I called you to greatness. I called you to fulfill more. I called you to a life of promise in the promised land. I want you to leave all of that behind because there's so much more ahead. Come on, that's for someone today. He didn't call you to less, he called you to more. That's what I want to do for you today. Come on, move towards everything that God has called you to.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.